Some people wonder why I bother going diving in the UK. After all, it's bloody cold and you're not going to see much wildlife, let alone any interesting wildlife. While it's true that UK diving requires more than a few of the warmest thermal layers ever invented, the animals and algae you see when you're down there more than make up for it. I'm going to take you on an underwater safari of the best marine wildlife I saw on a single dive trip off the south coast of England. But as an evolutionary biologist, I'm going to present them from least related to humans to most related to humans. This isn't to say that humans are in any way better than everything else. We're not. Or that we are the pinnacle of evolution. We're not. Nor that we are the most complex. We're just not. It does mean that we can see which adaptations happened a really long time ago and so are found in most of the tree of life, and which adaptations happened more recently and so only affect one or two branches. So squeeze into your dry suits and load up your lead as we fall backwards into an underwater jungle. Algae. I always thought of algae as the boring bit of the marine habitat, the frame in which the beautiful animal picture hangs. Turns out, their biology is so complex and interesting, there is no way I can fit it all in here. Now, just as you may have heard that there is no such thing as a fish, algae is a similarly meaningless word, as technically, land plants are a type of green algae, but then there are also red and brown algae that are completely different from plants that are also in the algae grouping. Much of the UK coastline is kelp forest, and just like trees in a forest, the kelp provides shelter and structure while also absorbing and fixing carbon. Globally, kelp forests capture 75% of all the carbon fixed in the sea, and are one of the most productive ecosystems on Earth. And it's honestly stunning swimming through these enormous trunk-like fronds as you catch glimpses of fish and then you see a mat of reds and pinks and purple algae covering the rocks underneath. Sponges. Leaving behind the plants and algae, we have sponges, the most basal animal group, meaning they split off from the rest of the animals ages ago and so lack many of the adaptations we see in other animals. They're not lesser animals for it. They have, after all, survived as a group for far longer than us mere mammals. But when you look at a sponge, it is hard not to call it primitive. They don't have true tissues or organs, there's no head, and there's no anus. However, this lack of complexity in the types of cells does give them one major superpower that we don't have. You can pass a sponge through a sieve to break it up into individual cells, and not only will the cells survive, they will regroup and form a whole sponge again. Just don't even imagine doing that to a human. It won't end well. Cnidaria. And we're onto the cnidaria. That's your corals, anemones, and jellyfish. We've gone up a level in cell complexity, and we've now got two layers of cells with a jelly filling between. That does mean that we only have one orifice for eating and excreting, though. A mouth anus, if you will. But although they've got simple tissues, they have evolved a wicked adaptation that we don't have. Cnidaria literally means nettle animals, because these animals have evolved stinging cells. And these are not just any stinging cells. These cnidocytes are trigger-activated, hydraulically propelled harpoons that can have piercing barbs, toxins, lassos, or glue at the end. That is hardly primitive. If they can pierce human skin, then the toxins are some of the most deadly in the animal kingdom. And if they can't, like these beadlet anemones, it just feels sticky or grippy on your fingers. Arthropods. Ah, we've reached the arthropods. From this point onwards, all the animals are bilateria. We've got three cell layers during development, which means we can now evolve a complete digestive tract with, get this, a separate mouth and anus. Hooray! Seriously though, biologists are so obsessed with mouths and anuses in particular that we split all the animals from this point into the ones that grow a mouth first as an embryo, the protostomes, and the ones that grow an anus first and therefore a mouth second, the deuterostomes. Arthropods are a group of protostomes, and boy are they a diverse group. In the sea, we have malacostraca instead of insects. That's your crabs, lobsters, crayfish, shrimp, and woodlice. And to once again drive home the point that just because a group split off earlier along the evolutionary tree does not make it basic or primitive or less evolved, just listen to the malacostraca parts list. They've got two pairs of antennae, compound eyes, three pairs of mouth parts, eight pairs of legs from the thorax, some of which might be specialised into pincers for feeding or defence, and six pairs of swimmerettes or appendages on the abdomen, which might themselves be specialised into catching food, brooding eggs, delivering sperm, or bearing gills. We don't have any of that. Special shout out to the spiny lobsters we saw in Cornwall. These were almost wiped out from overfishing because they live so long and take so long to reproduce. But they've been made a priority species on the UK Biodiversity Action Plan. And because we were diving next to a marine conservation zone where human activity is restricted, we were able to see quite a few of them as the population is now recovering. Good news. Echinoderms. We've now reached the group where the anus forms first. Oh yes. The earliest branching of the deuterostomes is the echinoderms, or the spiny skinned. So that's your starfish, sea urchins, and sea cucumbers. Once again, they've evolved powers that we lack. They've got hydraulically powered tube feet, which they use to move around and grip onto food, and they can regenerate legs and internal organs. You'll often see starfish missing a leg, or perhaps three, but they'll be absolutely fine and will just grow another one. Sea cucumbers can also squirt long, sticky tubes at threatening predators to entangle and immobilise them for long enough for the cucumber to just crawl away. However, I do have to read you verbatim one description of how they do it. Okay, it faces away from the attacker and contracts its body wall muscles sharply. So far, so good. This causes the wall of the cloaca to tear and the anus to gape and the free ends of some of the tubes to be ejected. Water is forced into these tubules, causing a rapid expansion, and they elongate by up to 20 times their original length. Ouch. Chondrichthyes. And we're finally at the more recognisable animals, the vertebrates. Vertebrates includes your five big groups, the fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and us mammals. And, as I know you're all wondering by now, we are deuterostomes, which means our anus forms first. Oh, so many anal facts in one video. We start off life as a hollow ball of cells, as an embryo, and then that first invagination becomes the butt. Hooray for the butt firsts! And vertebrates have now also evolved, you know, jaws and an adaptive immune system. Within the fish group, we have the chondrichthyes and osteichthyes, aka the fish with cartilage skeletons and the fish with bony skeletons. The cartilaginous fish includes the sharks, skates, and rays. And yes, before you ask, sharks are fish. And yes, there are sharks in the UK. I was so lucky and so happy to see a couple of lesser spotted dogfish, aka cat sharks. But we also have basking sharks, which is the second largest fish in the world, second to the whale shark, plus about 30 other species of shark that visit British waters, but none of them will attack a human unless provoked. You're absolutely safe in the UK. Recent research on this type of shark, the dogfish, found that sharks have personalities, or in biology speak, a repeatable behaviour across time and context that differ consistently among individuals. Social dogfish were happy to hang out in conspicuous groups in a new habitat. They're the life of the party, the extroverts. Whereas the less social sharks preferred to camouflage on the gravel bottom and stay hidden on their own. Aw, bless. Osteichthyes. We've now evolved bone! And there's also an anal upgrade. We now have separate openings for the anus, urine, and genitals, no longer stuck with a three-in-one. And if you didn't think there was already enough terminology with the osteichthyes and chondrichthyes, the bony fish are also split into two, the actinopterygians and the sarcopterygians, aka the ray-finned fish and the lobe-finned fish. I mean, just take a second. I had to memorise all of these terms for my undergrad degree. Take pity. Ray-finned fish. The ray-finned fish, or actinopterygians, make up pretty much all of what we think of when we think of a fish, including the wrasse. Wrasse are super common and there are over 600 species. So when in doubt, we divers just cheat and call every fish a wrasse. The word wrasse comes from crack, meaning old woman, which is the same root as the word hag, and is fitting because just like haggard old women, wrasse are colourful and beautiful. See what I did there? All wrasse start off life as females, and then some of them become males later in life. Usually there is a single dominant male, and when he dies, the most senior, biggest female will change sex and take over. Now this is the opposite of the clownfish species in Finding Nemo, because if you didn't know, Nemo's dad would almost certainly have been Nemo's mum by the time they reunited. Lobe-finned fish. And finally, the sarcopterygians, the lobe-finned fish. You might not think you know much about the sarcopterygians, but in fact, you know them intimately. And that's because, strictly speaking, and boy do I love a bit of pedantry, humans are lobe-finned fish, as are all the other land vertebrates. Now, usually we exclude the land animals from this grouping, but it's only for convenience and doesn't make any biological sense when we're considering who is most related to whom or who has evolved from whom. Hence, no such thing as a fish. Around 380 million years ago, some fish found their stubby, bony fins were quite good at crawling through shallow water that was full of mud and dead leaves. And being able to gulp air and hold it in lungs was really quite handy for breathing in stagnant water. So we now think fish were still living in the water when they evolved legs and lungs, but then once they had them, they were able to colonise the land. Over the next few hundred million years, some of these land fish evolved hair and homeothermy to keep warm, a big muscle called the diaphragm to breathe, and bigger brains to find food. Then a few of these lobe-finned fish decided they actually still quite liked being able to go underwater after all, but they were no longer very well adapted to life underwater, and they had to invent these ridiculously heavy and complex tanks, masks, hoses, and suits. But now that's a story for my third and final scuba video in this series. How exactly do you go scuba diving in the UK?
Hello, and welcome to my highly professional voiceover recording booth. Isn't this great? What's also great is this video is sponsored by New Scientist. I love getting paid. Thumbs up. So if you didn't grow up with New Scientist like I did, they are a science and technology magazine, both online and in print. And they write articles about new research, so like brand new papers that have just been published, technology, environment, all of these kind of things. But it's all for a general audience, so it's all super easy to understand. And with the link in the description, you can get 10 editions of the magazine for just £10, which in itself is an incredible deal. But also at that link, I have curated 3 articles that I think you'll particularly enjoy based on this video. So they're all on marine biology and evolution. There was one on fish have a dawn chorus, and they've got the audio file, so you can listen to the dawn chorus over a coral reef, which has just been discovered. There's one that some sharks have been found to be glow in the dark. Cool. And my favourite one, and bear in mind, New Scientists have no editorial control over this video. They didn't know exactly what this video was about. They already had, within the last month, an article about comb jelly anuses. So like jellyfish, an anus that comes and goes at will. How perfect is that for this video? So if you want to say thank you to New Scientist for giving me money and helping me continue to make a living making YouTube videos, you want to get that amazing 10 for 10 deal and read more about jelly anuses, then just go to the link in the description. Thanks.